Hey everyone, Inter here. This video is going to be a demonstration on the successes and failures of water travel. This is a little craft that I have made previously. It has some resemblances to the Seaplane 15 from my previous episode. It has lift engine, forward engine, it has yaw control surfaces on the wings. But the critical pieces that make it functional in the water are these water pylons, which on this plane are consisting of the static tail fin and the large control surfaces. Now these are just pieces that I'm familiar with using. The tail fins provide me enough vertical clearance, and the large control surfaces just happen to be compatible with my manner of flying aircraft. This aircraft is just an experimental one that I made today to demonstrate that other wing pieces will work just as effectively. You'll notice all the wing parts here are ones that I've not used on the seaplanes. But any wing piece in KSP will generate lift, and when placed underwater, that will become buoyancy. And as long as a static wing piece is the one that goes through the surface of the water, such as this rectangle piece up front, there will be no breakage when traveling at high speeds. Take the brakes off right now and just roll into the water. Again, entry and exit from the water should be done at or under the 12 meters per second threshold if you want to avoid any breakage. The exception with this, as we saw on the Seaplane 15, is when you're going at high enough speeds, you can exit the water as long as you clear the surface very quickly. What this plane is going to demonstrate in a few moments here is if any of the parts linger around the surface of the water for more than a split second, they will be broken off by the water tension. So we're going to get going here. You can see that we're picking up speed just as easily as the seaplanes do. Again, any wing parts will work for the water travel. But once we get up to speed and we start doing some turns here, because this plane is not balanced very correctly, you'll see that the wing parts, the pylons, almost instantaneously break off as soon as they touch the surface of the water. And that's it for the plane. Let's tab back over to the other one. And this one's balanced a little bit better. We'll be able to do a few more maneuvers with this, and hopefully I'll be able to show you the breakage in slower motion. Again, this configuration, the tail fin and the large control surface, is not necessarily the right way to do it. It's just the configuration that I use most often, and it seems to work best for me. Because this plane is so light, it tends to be a little bit unpredictable, so I'm actually going to try doing this at 2/3 throttle, and we'll start doing some turns here, see if I can break any pieces off. You can't quite make it. Those large control surfaces are still staying safely beneath the water. See if we can do a counter steer. If you quickly change directions in the water, that tends to throw the pylons a little bit higher. My goal here is to try to get one of them to break off so I can show you how it affects the rest of the plane as it continues to travel. Another thing you'll notice as you start building your own watercraft is the actual depth of the pylons in the water will be affected by the weight of the craft and how many parts you have generating lift underneath the surface of the water. Oh, almost at it. It's still resisting. Maybe we could take SAS off and that'll give us a little more chaos. I bet you we get it now. There we go, there's one, two, and goodbye, seaplane. Alright, I hope that helps.